dearest mother. Do not expect this to be an agreeable letter. I am too much disappointed in never hearing from home. The 17th of July is the last from you, almost 6 months. If you knew what I felt when the posts arrive and no letters for me. I shall write to nobody but you, for I feel I am too cross.
Like Mary Elgin in Constantinople in 1799, many diplomatic wives have felt the loneliness of life thousands of miles from home. My mother, a diplomat's wife for 28 years, was no exception. She wrote this letter from New Zealand in 1959.
We arrived in Cook Strait in lovely weather and docked at Wellington in bright sunshine and no wind. It was exciting to see this wonderful harbour, but it was horrid having no family among the cheering crowds at the quayside. The second secretary and chief clerk had come to meet us, looking most English and conspicuous by the very fact that they didn't look excited and weren't waving to anyone.
My mother's letters home, first to her parents and later to me, became the inspiration for me to look for others like them. What I discovered was the extraordinary but untold story of the women who for hundreds of years have represented Britain abroad. Many of these women were very young and were leaving home for the first time to take up their postings. Anne Disborough travelled to St. Petersburg in 1825 for what she believed would be just a three-month posting, leaving her two small daughters in the safekeeping of her parents.
June the 21st, 1826. These last 2 days seem to have lengthened the separation from my darling pets at least as many months. The day before yesterday completed the long, long year that has elapsed since I was blessed with a sight of those two precious rosy faces peeping under their green bonnets and driving off in such glee. It makes my heart ache to think of it. And yet I can think of little else. If I could only look forward to some certain period of our return, but this suspense, this total ignorance of when this happy event is likely to take place makes me doubly sad. Send me a curl from each of their dear pates. God bless them.
3 centuries of these private letters, diaries and memoirs reveal not only the difficulties of the years away from home, but also the spectacle and glamour of diplomatic life around the world. Their first task was to get themselves and their households to their destinations in one piece. Until my mother's generation, information on life abroad was pitifully scarce, and many women would have relied upon handbooks for advice, such as
Tropical Trials, a handbook for women in the tropics by Major S. Leigh Hunt,
first published in 1883.
The sudden and complete upset of old world life and the disturbance of long existing association produces in many women a state of mental chaos that utterly incapacitates them from making due and proper preparations for the contemplated journey. Few can realise the sacrifices they will be called upon to make in taking such a decided step. Many home comforts and a host of nameless social fascinations so dear to a woman's heart have to be given up, while the attractions offered by the irresistible day's shopping, the box at the opera, a few of our summer recreations, and nearly all our winter amusements must be temporarily relegated to the list of past pleasures.
But what to pack for a trip to an unknown country for years on end?
Take with you a most liberal supply of tulle, net, lace, ruffles, frillings, artificial flowers, ribbons, all those little etceteras that go so far in rehabilitating the oft-worn dress or bonnet. Piano. The manufacturer will pack the piano in a strong, tin-lined wooden case. You should take with it a tuning fork, a tuning key, and a set of glass footrests. Travelling baths. You should not omit to provide yourself with one of these baths. They are made of thin sheet iron, painted and varnished, and provided with a cover to fasten with a strong strap and padlock. When travelling, it forms a box, into which may be loosely packed a number of odds and ends required for daily use. And when it is unpacked, you will always have ready at hand the means of obtaining a refreshing bath. And this is a special consideration in the tropics.
With all her belongings packed, Mary Fraser, newly married to a secretary in the British legation in China, set off for Peking in 1874.
The parting with my people was unexpectedly terrible. Till the moment came, I had not realised what it was to mean, this going away for 5 years from everything that was my very own. And I remember I cried so long and so bitterly that the captain of the P&O steamer advised my husband to take me downstairs and let the stewardess put me to bed before I made myself really ill. Then I pulled myself together. Hugh rolled me up on a deck chair, made me drink a glass of champagne and put Lorna Doone, my mother's last gift, into my hands. And by the time the sun went down on a sea all crimson and gold, my thoughts were already flying forward to all the many strange and beautiful things I was so soon to see.
Ella Sykes left England in 1915 for Kashgar in Chinese Turkestan with similar apprehension and excitement. Avoiding the war in Europe, she began a 3-month trek across Scandinavia and down through Russia.
The farther east we went, the less food could we procure. And if it had not been for the soup packets we had brought from England, we should have been half starved. As it was, we were often unpleasantly hungry, hot water being the only thing we could be sure of obtaining. In spite of this, the journey was full of interest. We were travelling across limitless steppes, and the melting of the snow in patches showed that spring was at hand, when the sun would break forth from the grey, lowering skies. As we halted at Alexis, I suddenly saw the ungainly form of camels. Nearer and nearer they came, padding across the snow, drawing sleighs laden with hay, and with a leap of the heart, I realised that we were in the East, that Europe was left behind, and that we had entered that vast, mysterious continent of Asia, cradle of the human race and birthplace of its great religions.
But the hardest part was yet to come, the crossing of the Terek Darwan Pass, 12,000 feet up in the Tian Shan Mountains.
The next morning we started early, anxious to reach the top of the pass before the sun, now hot during the day, could melt the snow. To our intense relief, it was a superb day, a few fleecy clouds sailing across a deep turquoise sky. I was clad in a mixture of Arctic and tropical attire, wearing a leather coat under my thick tweed habit, woolen puttees and fur-lined gloves, along with a pith hat, blue glasses and a gauze veil. We soon came to the snow and zigzagged upwards on a narrow track, moving in single file, any animal in our caravan trying to pass another being liable to fall headlong in the soft, deep snow on either side. After a while, as we advanced, the great peaks towered on all sides, sharply silhouetted against their blue background. Nothing but white as far as the eye could reach. And here and there, skeletons sticking out of the snow bore eloquent witness to the terrible annual toll paid by the hundreds of horses and donkeys that have to cross this cruel pass. The last pull to the crest is almost perpendicular and is noted for accidents. Here my brother's pony nearly went over. But finally, caravan and all, we reached the summit of the pass in safety and dismounted to enjoy the fine view. Before us lay the great Alai range, peak towering above peak of boldly serrated mountains. Over us hovered a huge vulture, and as I looked down the track in front, where the snow was partly melted, hideous heaps of bones were revealed, and I felt that the ill-omened bird would never lack food so long as nothing was done to improve this execrable road.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.